It is time now to head into the chat room, and joining me today is 3AW's Neil Mitchell in Melbourne and 9 Sylvia Jeffries in Sydney. Good afternoon to both of you.
Yeah, hello.
Hi, Amber.
Now, first up today, women are working more and earning more than ever before, but they're still spending an average of 14 hours on housework. That's 14 hours more than men compared to their husbands, according to the latest Household Income and Labour Dynamics Survey, which has been really, really interesting. Even women who earn the same as their partner are doing more unpaid duties. Let's go first to you, Sylvia. So why do you think Aussie women are still doing more at home, even if they're in paid employment and even if it's for the same time and even the same money?
It's interesting, isn't it? 14 hours a week, that's a big difference between what men and women are apparently putting in with duties at home. But I wouldn't say it's necessarily all that surprising. To me, we know that when it comes to domestic duties, we're talking about centuries-old social structures. And yes, they are slowly but surely breaking down, but it's going to take a very long time to peel that back and to start again. So I think we have to probably be a little bit patient in that respect. We also know, I think no one will argue with me here, that women are better multitaskers. They just get stuff done. Neil, I know you won't disagree with that. But we do have to be very conscious, I think, of the added stresses that women in 2019, in this day and age, are carrying between those professional responsibilities, the duties they have to perform at home, and, you know, let's not forget the exorbitant cost of childcare on top of all of that as well. A mother today probably has more on her plate than ever before, and if we don't address that and we don't think about it seriously, it could lead to some really serious social issues.
Yeah, it certainly could. Neil, were you surprised at this survey, and do you think it will ever change?
No and no. I don't. I did my own little Hilda survey with the audience today and asked women why are they stressed, and the answer was simple: men. Men. Men are clumsy, useless. They seem to be able to tie their shoelaces and go out to work and survive in the world. But the minute they get home, they're stupid and useless. I was amazed by the response we got from women. Quite seriously, they said they do most of the work. Men can't multitask. They might want to help, but they forget the kids' dental appointment, and they don't know when there's got to be a special costume ready for book club, and they go to sleep when they should be sitting up in the middle of the night worrying about these things. That's what happened.
But you know why? I think sometimes women are their own worst enemy. Sometimes we're such perfectionists. We do it because we want it done the way we want it done.
Oh, yes, and we couldn't possibly do it right, could we? So you've got to do it. How is it we survive
in the world?
I am not like
that. I must say, when I had my first child, I went, do you know what? I can't do everything. I just can't do it. Something has to give. So I said to my husband, choose one thing. Whatever you like, choose one thing, that is your thing. So he chose cooking. I have not cooked a meal since my now 9-year-old daughter was born. He does all the cooking, he does all the food shopping, and I just put it into his hands. Did you know what? Sometimes I think, oh, maybe that's, you know, not how I would have done it, or maybe that's not what I would have done, but I've just had to let go. And as a result, in our house, it's pretty equal. Like, I do all the washing and I put, you know, all the stuff in the dishwasher, and we've just equaled it, and it actually really works. But for me, I know a lot of women would struggle to do that, and I've just had to do it, and as a result, he's a great cook. So look, it's a win-win in my household.
Not me, Amber. I do not struggle to come home at night and accept a meal on the table, and I'm very lucky I get to do that as well. My husband cooks Monday to Friday as well, which is a serious
bonus. What does he cook? Sausages.
He cooks all sorts of, sometimes sausages, bit of tuna mornay on a special occasion.
Tuna mornay out of a can.
Out of a can.
So
yes.
That's what we had
last night.
We can't be bagging these efforts. I think we just have to accept it. We're just going to take it, don't we, Sylvia? All right, let's move on. Yeah. And this same report shows commute times around the country are on the rise. Sydney workers spend on average 71 minutes getting to and from work. Brisbane workers spend 66 minutes, and Melbourne workers spend 65. Now, it comes as the figures show Victoria is adding 300 cars and trucks every day to that road. That's similar figures in states around the country. So, Neil, do we need to put a cap on the number of cars on our roads? Otherwise, it's just going to get busier and busier and busier.
Well, I don't think we can. I don't think you can stop people owning a car, and you can't cap the number of cars that are registered because people can only drive one car at one time. Well, it's going to change, though. I think we'll end up with the user pay systems, probably, where you pay by the kilometre. And the trucks are a huge problem. I think 134,000 trucks and utes in 4 years added to our roads in Victoria. We've got to look at truck delivery times. We've got to look at options for moving stuff around the place. We've got to look at opening up clearways. We've got a real problem because of population growth. The infrastructure can't keep up with it, and we're going to have to address it. You can't restrict people using a car, but you're going to, I'm afraid, you have to find a way of managing it better.
Sylvia, do you think capping the number of cars could be an answer?
I just can't ever see that happening. We love our cars too much in Australia, and I think we all enjoy the freedom of being able to drive ourselves from A to B to C to D whenever we like, however we like. And I just think that's something that a government is not going to have any success getting across the line in this country. It's going to be highly unpopular as a policy. What is more inevitable, as Neil says, is probably something like a user pay system, maybe a congestion tax in inner city areas. I think that's probably an inevitable outcome in Melbourne, in the Melbourne CBD at some stage, perhaps not in Brisbane yet. But what did stand out to me about that is that in Brisbane, a city that has half the population of Melbourne, their commute time is a minute longer than
Melbourne's. Yeah, I was surprised at that too. I didn't know if they were just coming from further distances, maybe.
Well, I think what you have to take into account in Brisbane, the entire spread across the southeast corner, which includes Logan, Ipswich, the Gold Coast, and people are moving further away where, of course, real estate and renting is cheaper and they're commuting into the city. So, you know, projects like the Cross River Rail, they're so crucial to getting people moving around the city. But a cap on cars, I cannot see that ever happening.
All right. Did you know that half of Aussies under 30 are still living with their parents? It's being blamed on the expensive housing market and the decline in marriage rates. I don't know, Sylvia, is this necessarily a bad thing? Would you want your kids to be still living with you at 30?
I was probably putting the cart before the horse a little bit, but I would say probably not. However, the circumstances are such that it is really hard for people to get ahead these days, especially when you consider the fact that in a city like Sydney, the median house price hasn't been below $1 million since 2015. So saving a $200,000 deposit is really, really hard, and people below the age of 30 are really up against it in that respect. But I guess it kind of goes full circle in that with an ageing population, we will be taking in our parents as they get older later in life as well. So while they may be giving a little bit more to us up until our 30s, we might be giving a little bit more to them.
Yeah, good luck.
Yeah, maybe. Neil, at least I guess young people are saving some money. Do you think this is a bad thing?
I'm still staggered at the thought of my kids looking after me as I get older.
Surely they'll look after you, Neil.
My son has just reached, well, he's 31, has just moved out of home.
There you go. Well, this stat is talking to you. How did you find that?
He might be watching. It's terrific having them around up to a point, but we're too easy on them. It's the mollycoddling argument again. You treat it like a share house, fair enough, if they've got to do their share of work, pay their share of the costs, but mums spoil them. It's the mum guilt thing coming through. They do
fault.
The washing, they look after them. They'll be 30. It didn't happen with my son, but 30-year-olds will have their beds made for them. Now, come on, they've got to learn the world a bit quicker than that.
They do, but I have brainwashed my children to say even if they move out, they have to live in the same street as me.
You'll change your mind.
Change my mind. They're very young and they're very cute at the moment and I haven't gone through the teenage years, ask me then. All right, finally today, a study in America has found that watching lowbrow TV like the Kardashians and the Real Housewives actually makes you dumber. Neil, this is a real thing. It lowers your IQ. I mean, are you surprised?
1.8 points it lowers your IQ over 10 years. Yeah, I didn't expect it to qualify you for a PhD, but I can't see it lowering your... I'd speak in defence of junk TV. I don't watch Pimple Popper and things like that, I will watch some of the pretty ordinary stuff just to let it flow over you and relax. I read detective novels on holidays to relax. I'm happy to watch a bit of... not bimbo battles for blokes and things, but a bit of junk TV.
What's your favourite junk TV, Neil?
I watched this thing about a chateau that they're rebuilding in France, and it's predictable, it's a bit cliché, but it just flows over you, it's a bit of fun.
My husband loves those reno shows. Sylvia, would these results change what you watch on TV?
Absolutely not. No, it is my God-given right to go home after a long day of work and binge on reruns of Seinfeld and Friends and The Hills,
that's good.
It's true, actually, Seinfeld's the greatest television show of all time, so I'm with you on that. But if you have... Exactly, apart from Nine News Now. If you have a look at the actual study, though, it's very convoluted and it goes back to Italian viewing habits in the 1980s. So, I don't know, maybe it's my Gen Y attention span, which happens to be quite short, but I would say it's a junk report, Amber. Just throw it in the bin.
A junk report. We shouldn't believe this stuff. Well, that's good to hear because I tell you what, there's a lot of it going on in our house. I think my husband watched something like Ice Road Truckers and Storage Wars.
I told you it was useless. I told you it was no good. He's a man.
He's great. Got to leave it there, Neil and Sylvia. It has been fabulous to have you on the chat room. It's got to be better than junk TV, right?